So I'm Michael Russell. I work at Schuberg Philis as a mission critical engineer. And what we do at Schuberg Philis is we provide infrastructure outsourcing for clients. So specifically in my team, I work in the software as a service team. And in that team, what we try to do is actually build shared services that can be used by customer teams. So what you have to imagine is that you've got five different teams working, and they all need a monitoring solution. So what used to happen is everyone would go, hey, let's build Nagios, someone else would start building Sensu, everyone starts solving the same problems and trying to build the same solution, integrating with our paging system, integrating with Slack, everyone doing the same work. So what my team tries to do is actually build these as a single service that can actually be reused and try to sort of get everyone to work on the same product together and improve it. So I've also got crossed out Andy Repton. So in the first two times I've done this, for anyone who saw that, I actually presented it with him. So I've left his name on here just to remind me that some of this, half the slides used to be his. So if I sound like I don't know what I'm talking about, or I look a bit lost, or if I just stand there and looking to my right for someone else to start, that's probably why, because he's not here. So also I've got, I think, 40 minutes, something like that. So it's speech is around 20, 25 minutes. So if you have any questions, feel free to ask during the speech, because I really like to have a bit of interaction. Otherwise, I'm just talking to myself and everyone's staring, pretending they know what Kubernetes is. So who's actually used Kubernetes before? Who's using it in production? Cool. So this is a pretty slide with lots of different tools that we're using. So Docker, of course, Kubernetes, for the people who don't know the logo. CoreOS is what we're actually running as the operating system. Jenkins we're using for testing. Vault for secrets management. Git, storing code, that's a cool one. Sensu is our monitoring solution. I believe this is the etcd logo. Maybe someone can help me out. Yeah, cool. This one's Prometheus, also being used for monitoring. Flannel we've actually gotten rid of, which was used for the overlay networking. We're now just using native host networking. And we're using Ansible to actually deploy everything. I think you got my head in that photo.
If you have some money left, use Splunk.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's, we've been told we're using too much and we're growing the licensing fees. So that might become an elk soon. So when we first started building this, my colleague Andy sort of did a bit of a POC, and he was originally choosing Terraform to configure everything. And this was really nice because you could just run Terraform apply, and you've got a Kubernetes cluster. And this was really cool. We started playing with it, and then people actually thought like, hey, I want to change something, or I want to upgrade a version or something. So change Terraform plan, Terraform apply, destroying all instances, creating all instances, everything's gone. So the problem with that is that there was no way to actually orchestrate any sort of changes or do rolling upgrades, or you could roll back, but you'd lose all your data in the process as well. So we really needed something that could actually be built on, be incrementally rolled out, actually tested, a bit better sort of variables where you can actually manage different versions, different clusters, have one running alpha features, one without it, all of that kind of stuff. So we then moved across to Ansible to do this. And the really nice thing about this is that it solved all those problems I was just talking about. So we're able to actually do rolling upgrades. So very specifically, upgrade a node, wait for it to get back into the cluster. If it doesn't work, hey, stop. Something's gone terribly wrong with this and it's not going so well. And the other big advantage of this is that we could actually support multiple clouds and multiple instance sizes. So we could say we want the node running in CloudStack, which is our private cloud that Miguel used to work on. And we could also say we want the master components to be running in Amazon. And then we can say we actually want one instance or three or scale up and down, and we actually have that flexibility by deploying with Ansible. Another sort of bonus that we got from this that we had trouble solving with Terraform is that we're able to actually install the secrets management and do that client side. So Ansible would actually connect to Vault, which is storing the secrets, and then send those securely over SSH to actually configure what it needed to do, and not needing to store that as cloud metadata for a little while and hope it expires or something. So this is the fun part of the talk, and if you have questions, please ask them now. Yes, Miguel?
I guess you didn't replace Terraform completely, right?
So Terraform is still just provisioning the nodes, and then we just expect to have like 9 CoreOS nodes. So this means that our requirements right now are just we need CoreOS nodes, so we also have some which aren't provisioned by Terraform that are managed outside of CloudStack or something.
Right. So what happens when you need to scale your cluster? Is it still Terraform?
Yep, so Terraform's actually creating the instances, and then Ansible's provisioning them. So we're just never using Terraform to actually reprovision all the instances at once, like we were before. So once Terraform's done its job, we just use Ansible after that. It's really just an easy way to create instances. Yeah.
Any bare metal in this?
Yes, so the actual team who runs the cloud are now running their sort of management layer besides cloud stack, which is manually managed, which is doing some usage and things like that, is actually running Kubernetes nodes that are connecting to inside the cloud that's managing. So there's some funky stuff going on. This is good, lots of questions. So this is the really fun part. So Kubernetes in Kubernetes. So one of the problems we started to have was that we had a lot of different Kubernetes clusters, and we had to manage heaps of different versions, doing rolling upgrades, handling monitoring for them, creating new instances, and this started to become a lot of overhead. And we were looking for a way to actually better manage this. And we're looking around thinking, are there any tools which are good at managing lots of different sort of little microservices which have APIs and things like that? And we thought, hey, Kubernetes can do that. So I think the diagram's a little bit out of date, but what you need to imagine is that we have a Kubernetes cluster, which is just a normal Kubernetes cluster. So three masters running on CoreOS, three actual nodes which are running the containers, also on CoreOS, and a dedicated etcd cluster. So just a standard Kubernetes setup. So then when we talk about Kubernetes in Kubernetes, we have the Kubernetes master component, so the API server, the scheduler, and the control manager running as pods inside of the main Kubernetes cluster. So that just looks like any other kind of service that's exposed. So you'll create the new master components, and there'll be a Kubernetes API server running as a pod in a container that's actually exposed on a public IP. So then what happens is we provision nodes, which are just physical CoreOS nodes, or they could be some bare metal nodes running somewhere else. And then these ones actually connect into the endpoint that's created in the main Kubernetes cluster to connect to it. So what this actually functionally looks like is that we have a Kubernetes cluster, and we do a kubectl get pods, which shows you all of your deployments and containers and everything. And in there, we'll actually see all of the different master components. So this means if we want to upgrade from version 1 to 1.4 to version 1.5, it's just like deploying a new version of a Kubernetes application that you're running. So this would just be bumping an image, changing a variable, kubectl apply, and Kubernetes is going to do the rolling upgrade for the master components. And then the same thing for the rollback. Yes?
What happens if you want to upgrade the main cluster? Yeah.
Then you just update it like you would. So if you imagine, so when we're updating one of these subclusters, they're called, any application in there, if there needs to be a restart of Docker or something on one of the nodes, those containers will just be respawned on another node. That's the idea of Kubernetes. So the same thing happens for our management cluster. So if you've got your API server for your subcluster, for example, and there's three of them running on three nodes, and this node dies or gets restarted, you still got the other two here, and this one will be managed like any other Kubernetes deployment would be.
But the Kubernetes cluster running the other clusters, that one?
The base one.
The base one, that's the...
Yeah.
So that one, how do you upgrade that one? Because that's not running as a Kubernetes application.
That one's managed by Ansible. So this means we do have a bit of
duplicate
work. You still
have to do the Ansible stuff.
Just for the management cluster. So we maintain a Kubernetes cluster, and then as one of our applications running in that is more Kubernetes clusters.
So you needed many Kubernetes clusters. That's the problem you solved with.
Yeah, so we have sort of our own Kubernetes cluster, which we're using to deploy the master components for other Kubernetes clusters. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Does the new federation feature, is it going to change the way you set this up?
To be honest, I haven't really looked into it. What can it actually do now?
It's like a control plane crossing multiple availability zones for a single Kubernetes cluster.
I don't think that solves the same problems. But for example, namespaces do.
Yeah.
Like, namespaces separate your cluster into several pieces, so...
It doesn't actually protect anything from talking to each other. So between namespaces, you still have communication, and that's mm-hmm. one of the designs of Kubernetes, is that all containers can talk to all containers, even across namespaces.
Okay.
So it's not going to be acceptable for one customer to talk to another customer.
Right. So we also wanted isolation. You know,
yep.
Multi-tenant Kubernetes, let's call it like.
Yeah, so one advantage is that the actual containers are fully isolated because they're on their own nodes, but it also means that a customer, one of the teams, can put them in their own network. So now they're actually able to locally connect to the services they need to, but the endpoint and the actual management of Kubernetes, which is managing the nodes, is maintained by us. So those nodes can be run anywhere. Mm-hmm. I could even make my own laptop a Kubernetes node and connect into one of the clusters, so it would just be functioning as running containers for it, and it'd be managed somewhere else by running it inside of the other Kubernetes cluster. So the one thing which has changed since I last did this is we're now using a shared etcd cluster. So originally etcd was being run as a pet set inside of that cluster, but this meant that we had to maintain a sort of stateful database inside of that, and we also found out that PetSets were an alpha feature. So there's more stories on that later on about why you should not be using alpha features. Any more questions before we go on?
Did you look into a boot cube?
Into?
Boot cube.
What can it do?
It's a similar thing, only you stay with the same hardware. So boots up, it uses a similar API control plane, a small API control plane.
Yeah.
To boot new Kubernetes control plane and then switches around. So you do the more or less the same benefits, but you stay with the same hardware. It's the another set of hardware for your control plane.
Cool, I'll have a look. Yeah.
So you said that you got rid of plan and you switched to host native network, which means that you assign as slash 24 to each host?
So right now, so the actual nodes are still provisioned by Ansible. So right now our default is host networking. So this assumes that wherever the nodes are running, that they can connect layer 2. So what happens is that they're assigning, like I think it's 10.192 subnet, and that they're able to connect to that without needing to actually go through any networking hardware because they're all within the same layer 2 network. So it means that if someone did want to run nodes across different clouds or something, they would have to use something like Flannel, which is still an option. Does that sort of answer what you were asking?
Yeah, I don't know. It's,
but that range is sort of only seen by those nodes itself. It never routes outside of the cluster for the pod-to-pod networking.
The idea is to get rid of all L2 networking, just have routing at the host, but we can talk about it.
Yeah, because Flannel is only necessary if you can't directly route between the nodes, which in all of the cases we've had so far we can, so that's what we're using as a default. Yep.
I didn't completely get the last question, but you were using node-hosted networking, right?
For yep.
Each node, so how do you keep the pods from conflicting with their ports?
So when Ansible's provisioning the nodes, depending on what node it is, it's assigning its network. So the first one will be 10.192.1, whatever, and adds the routes directly to the other nodes.
Right.
So each node has its own subnet, and they can all connect to each other from... I can show you a bit later if you like.
Sure.
It will be a bit more clear.
Okay.
So, testing. So when we started doing this, we found there was a lot of complexity, and it was very easy to break something. So whether this was version upgrades, finding out alpha API features had disappeared because you shouldn't use them, or that a CoreOS upgrade had caused issues by removing certain binaries that were being used, such as SOCAP, which broke all kind of port forwarding and features like that, which was a bit of a nasty one. So we found that we really needed to start actually testing, does this work? So right now, I think this is up to date. So right now, whenever you fire up a merge request, it will actually, using Terraform, create a project in CloudStack, so from scratch, starting with nothing, and in there I'll actually deploy the management cluster, so the main cluster with the 3 MOS components, 3 CD, and 3 nodes, and then we'll actually do GOS infrastructure testing. So this is a bit like server spec, so this is a very quick, is Docker installed, is Docker running, are these binaries available, is it actually listening on the correct ports and not publicly, those sorts of really basic things. And then next we have a tool written by one of our developers called K8S Tester. So this is a Go tool, which is testing all of those things that I said broke before. So does port forwarding work? Can you actually proxy stuff? Can you deploy some pods and do networking between different nodes? If you actually kill a node, does something happen? So after that, the monitoring is deployed as part of the pipeline. And then we've got an actual script which forces all the monitoring checks to run as part of the pipeline as well. So any new monitoring tests are also part of this testing process. So once this is all done, we then repeat the same thing for one of the subclusters. So this is also another really good way to test Kubernetes, is can you deploy this complicated subcluster setup? So then that whole process starts, also checking the monitoring, also running the K8S testing again.
How long does it take?
20 minutes.
Really?
Yeah, wow. And that's spawning, so 9 deploying, another 9 connecting, and...
Did you have a server just for that?
We're spawning in CloudStack. So the most of the slowness is how long the VPC creation takes, which I'm sure you can talk all about, and that kind of stuff. So doing this all in 20 minutes is pretty impressive when you consider how much is actually being created and tested for this.
Is it within the same zone?
So the way we have CloudStack set up is a bit unique. We're not using zones properly, but we have availability zones. So each of the different instances are spawned in different availability zones. So yes, but no. So next is monitoring. And this was really the first part of Kubernetes which was actually different. So the actual application itself is just your standard, I've got an API that needs to run, I have a database which needs to run, which is etcd, and I've got some kind of clustering going on, but there's nothing too really fancy going there. Etcd clusters really nicely, it handles failures well, backing it up is really simple, so there was nothing too crazy going on. So when I actually came to monitoring, this was back when we had the Terraform. So you've got to remember that the sort of constraints of this were, if we had to make any changes to the cluster itself, it required destroying the whole thing or doing it manually. So this meant that actually installing any kind of monitoring configuration like a Sensu client or Nagios NLP or anything on the nodes was just not possible. And so the next thing was, hey, can we do monitoring from within Kubernetes, monitoring the stuff that it's running in? So I'm like, hey, that's a good idea. But then we realized that Kubernetes is only managing the nodes. So if you were to run a daemon set, which allows you to run containers on all of your nodes, you'd still have nothing running on the master components or the etcd cluster, which can be thought of as being sort of not managed by Kubernetes. So what we came up with in the end is there's a really nice tool called Node Exporter, and this is, once again, written in Go, and it runs on each of the core REST nodes and exposes an API endpoint with Prometheus statistics. So with this, you can actually check services, you can check outputs from custom scripts that are running, CPU, memory, disk, all of those kinds of basic checks. So is this node actually sort of working a little bit? So that's running. And then from within the Kubernetes cluster itself, we have a Prometheus, which is running. And this is really meant as a sort of buffer. So this Prometheus is connecting to each of the node exporters. And it's actually scraping in all of these metrics. So now we actually have a Prometheus running inside of the Kubernetes cluster that's scraping everything. And then what we have is a Sensu client also running inside of Kubernetes, and this one is actually querying Prometheus for data. So this one's actually checking heartbeats from Prometheus, it's checking disk usage, it's predicting if disks are going to get full, if you're going to run out of inodes for spawning too many containers, are the services we expect to be running actually running? So then we also run a few other checks. So the KDS tester we talked about before, that one's also running on a schedule testing the functionality. And we also have another tool called Check KDS, really good generic name, and this one is really meant as a way to actually monitor stuff running in Kubernetes. So if I have a deployment running, how do I know the health checks are actually successful? So the idea of this one is that on a namespace, you'll actually enable this as a namespace with important stuff running in it, and I want it to be monitored. So what will actually happen is, in this namespace, any health checks are on here. If any of these fail, that will actually trigger an alert. And if you Now, this isn't a good screenshot, but a really nice thing with Sensu is that you've got an API where you can actually sort of fake the host name. So this means inside of Sensu, you'll actually see the different namespaces listed as hosts, and you'll actually see the different deployments also listed as different service checks. So the nicer part about doing this is that you can also check things such as, is my deployment running highly available? So is it in multiple zones, or is it running on a single node? So this means that now that we pretty much tell the developers, hey, deploy your application, write a health check for it, and we'll make sure that health check wakes you up at 3 a.m. when it's going wrong. And there's nothing else that actually needs to be configured on a monitoring level. They don't need to know what monitoring system's running or how the alert actually gets to them. Yes?
How do they write that?
So, do you know how the health check functions work in Kubernetes?
Yeah, I kind of have an idea.
So in Kubernetes, you can actually...
I mean, how can you give developers, because you mentioned you use Sensu and Prometheus and all sorts of things, even your own testing tool for monitoring?
Yep.
But I guess Kubernetes also does monitoring, right? Of health, of containers. If a container dies,
it will respawn it, but it's also possible that the health check is failing, for example, because it can't connect to a database. So the idea is that an application...
So it's a more functional check.
So this is more for actually checking applications that are running in it. Yeah. So imagine you have an API which connects to a database, and the health check is actually checking, can I connect to my database? And database goes down, so the health check will actually fail. So the health check will actually then cause a page to happen, depending on how it's configured based on how many replicas do you expect to have. So you would, in a normal case, you would expect it to restart somewhere and be able to connect, but if it can't, you actually want to know.
So then health check goes into Kubernetes.
So it's a definition for your deployment. So if you deploy an application, you'll say, this is the image, these are environment variables, and this is the health check. So that can either be a command, or it can be an endpoint to slash health on your application. And so that's up to the developers to actually deploy. So this means if they're adding in a new feature, the monitoring is part of that application, part of their deployment as well. And that we don't need to be aware of new features being added. They don't need to know how the monitoring actually works.
Your developers are interacting with Kubernetes directly?
Yes. So it's up to them how they actually do that. So some teams are using Helm for managing applications. Some are just doing normal Kubernetes, kubectl. They can really do whatever they want to break stuff, which is a fun challenge. So this is sort of a lessons learned and challenges. So a few fun stories and surprises that you might run into if you start to set up this yourself. So the first one, kubectl connection timeouts. So I mentioned we had that really nice testing pipeline where we actually tested all our monitoring checks and did these things. So when we're testing the monitoring checks, what we would do is actually run a command inside a container and hope for that to be returning a zero. Is it okay? So running this for a while, it was always green, everything worked perfect. We test, does it fail? If it's actually failing, yes it does, great. And then after a little while, we actually found a problem where port forwarding wasn't working. And we thought, that's weird, we test this. This isn't possible. I've got proof that this works. And what we found out is that networking was timing up, and it meant that the end-to-end test was taking more than a minute, which was the default timeout for the HAProxy inside of CloudStack. And if kubectl gets a connection timeout, it just exits with a zero, like, you know, the container just disappeared, not a big deal. And Jenkins was like, hey, exit goes zero, everything's good, right? So we actually had to change that to a run a container with a command, actually wait for it to complete, and then actively check, did the command actually finish running and return a proper exit code. So it means it's what used to be a single line kubectl run command is now, I think, like a 20 line bash script of spawning it, waiting for it to come up, actually check that the return code is right and that text is there that we expect. So those sort of one-off jobs are still a bit of a hacky workaround when you try to run that kind of stuff. So what a lot of people then will try and do is use the scheduled task thing, which I mentioned before, so the Alpha API features. So if you actually, is anyone using the Alpha API features for the people running Kubernetes? Good, good, good. So if you look at their definition, stable is as you would expect stable. Beta feature is something where this is a feature which is here and will be supported in the future, but there may be breaking changes which will have an upgrade path. So beta features, like, yeah, you can use them, but just be aware of when you're upgrading that maybe I need to change this, maybe it's going to need to be delete the deployment and recreate it or something. And the alpha features, it pretty much says, use this if you want to contribute to the community and help test things. And it can change between minor versions or disappear completely, and we're not testing any stability with this enabled. So just enabling a feature like this can cause unexpected bugs everywhere else. So for the first few months, we had this enabled by default. So it wasn't causing any stability issues, but it meant that developers were actually starting to use these features, which were causing weird issues for them as well. So we're now in a scenario where you need to manage different versions. And if you want to upgrade to a new version, you actually need to sort of talk to the teams, like, is this actually going to break your application? You need to test this upgrade path, and are you using any features which have changed slightly or don't exist anymore? So we've got one team right now who's stuck on an old version until they can find another way to do scheduled jobs, because that feature just sort of got thrown away for the moment. One of the other fun surprises is pod rescheduling and balancing. So one of the really cool things that you get with Kubernetes is that if you kill a node, that pod just goes somewhere else, which is great, because you no longer need to actually worry about physical nodes or where anything's running anymore. And if that node dies, then it just moves somewhere else. But so if you imagine a scenario where you're doing rolling restarts of stuff. So you've got three nodes, and you've got a deployment with three pods running. And right now it's on node one, node two, and node three. You kill node one, so Kubernetes goes, oh, no one's dead, that's fine. I'll start that pod somewhere else. So now it starts on node two. So you've now got two pods running on node two, and one pod running on node three. So node two dies, now they move over to node three. Also fine, right? That's sort of what it's supposed to do. You've said that's okay. So right now you've got one node running, you've got everything running on there. And the nodes come back up, or you fix them or something like that. So what you would expect to happen now is Kubernetes goes like, hey, we've got some room, let's move these pods around again and get things running nicely. But what it does is it goes like, oh, there's room for these pods to run here. I'm actually quite comfortable like this, and just leaves them on that single node. So the thing is that there's no actual active rescheduling or balancing of your deployment. So this is something you really need to actually monitor and check. Is this running how I expect? And I think the reasoning behind this is that, at least on a Google level, they expect you to be running 1,000 nodes, where the idea of actually restarting all of them in order and having those three end up on one node is just impossible to imagine. It's not supposed to be funny. This woke me up at night.
When I was even more funny.
You guys are cruel. So CPU. So CPU and memory limits. So for anyone who's run something like CloudStack or a private cloud before, this will, I think, really speak to you. So you've got to imagine that if you create, in a normal scenario, you'll create a virtual machine on a hypervisor, and there'll be a limit on the amount of disk space it has, how much CPUs it has access to, how much memory it has access to, and it might even have its own virtual network interface. So you can give this to someone, they can do whatever they like, go crazy, fill up a disk, whatever, it doesn't matter. You've got your sort of, they're sandboxed in like that. So when it comes to containers, you can set CPU limits and you can set memory limits. So there's no way to actually enforce everyone to actually use these limits or anything. So what this means is that you're giving sort of a hypervisor to someone and saying, create a VM, and by default it has unlimited CPU, unlimited disk, and unlimited memory, and, you know, please don't break anything. So the problem with this is that disks can fill up, and we have stuff that's running on there, so it needs to actually be able to connect to Kubernetes. So you need to actually find some kind of balance where you allow your customers to fully use CPU and memory and disk and break stuff, but your own stuff needs to keep running as well. So the sort of current defensive approach we take is educate the users on how to use the limits properly, because it protects them as well, stops them from spawning 4,000 pods in a loop from alpha features. And the only way we can do this is to actually protect our own processes. So using old school things like NICing processes and actually reserving memory and CPU for our own applications, but you still can't do anything with disk usage, for example. That's not a feature available yet. So it's really just a, please don't have logs that are filling up or writing storage that keeps going and exploding. So that leads to the next really interesting challenge, which is who's responsible for the nodes. So we're expected to actually provision these nodes and manage them and make sure they can connect to Kubernetes, and that's Docker's running. But if you then have developers who are filling up disks, causing load of 500, mounting the Docker socket and running containers as root and doing whatever they want, it becomes a really interesting challenge of who's actually in charge of these. They've got full access, they can break it however they want, but we need stuff working as well. So monitoring pages still goes to us. Yeah?
So for both the CPU memory limits and the concern of running things as root, have you considered running something like Hyper on top of Kubernetes? There's a project called Fractai that replaces your local Docker daemons basically with a very, very thin KVM machine, so you can run your pods in a VM that is completely isolated from your host.
So how would you define those limits on a Kubernetes level, the API?
I guess it's just you can at least specify the memory, like you would do normally, I guess.
Yeah.
And I guess they're working on adding more limits. So in KVM, you actually can set things like I/O bandwidth properly. So memory is out, of course, out of the question. You can control the memory first, but the rest can be managed, I guess.
Because the real problem is that, like right now, Docker itself supports setting limits for disks as well, but Kubernetes hasn't implemented that.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons of that is that they also support Rocket as a runtime, for example. So they need to find feature parity and actually support the minimum things. And then you still run into the problem of, are you going to now enforce quotas on all of the namespaces of a cluster that a developer is using? So if they create a new namespace, are we going to have something which automatically starts applying limits and stopping them from doing stuff? So it becomes a fine balance, because then if we want to upgrade to a new version, we also now need to make sure that all of those limits we're enforcing on them are still available as well. So it becomes a really interesting scenario where their application is really tied into the infrastructure. So doing a sort of upgrade of the underlying components actually affects the applications which are running there. So even with Docker, for example, kernel features, modules which could be enabled or not, can actually affect, like if you're running keep alive D inside of container because you're using it for CI testing in GitLab or something, that used to work on our Jenkins node with Docker on it because the kernel module was enabled that it needed. On CoreOS, it was disabled and caused a kernel panic and actually killed the node. So these sorts of really fun scenarios that you wouldn't expect to run into because you think, hey, it's a container, it's all contained, right? Everyone's just laughing at me, but this is pain.
Except the crucial my container, so it's
yeah.
We're not laughing at you, we're laughing at him.
Good. Any other questions?
How do you expose services? Do you leverage the call stack?
Expose what, sorry?
Services. Use load balancer.
Yeah, so we've actually built the load balancer provider for cloud stack. So right now you can actually expose with a load balancer, and that will create a cloud stack load balancer. I see Miguel making funny faces because the load balancers and cloud stack are like the cloud team's like, oh, you're using those.
Yeah.
Okay, good luck with that. But the main problem right now is that managing the ACLs isn't part of the provider just yet. So this is the same. So when you talk about having to support Docker and Rocket as container runtimes, with the cloud providers, they've gone the other route, where all the cloud providers have different feature levels. So with an AWS cloud provider, you can provide the ACLs. But the cloud stack one, we haven't built that in yet, so it's not there. So if you try and do it, it just goes not implemented. And good luck. Yeah.
Basically, offering some kind of runtime platform, in my opinion. What do you do with states? Can developers figure it out themselves, or do you offer some kind of shared NoSQL, shared relational database, shared file system?
So you mean actually like shared storage and stuff?
Yeah.
So this is where I look at the cloud team again. we want actually, so the cloud provider support in Kubernetes has offers for like volumes and things, but right now we're sort of debating whether to wait for that to be a cloud stack feature where we can actually have that be managed by another team, or whether we need to actually build our own sort of storage cluster. So right now we're really only taking on people who are interested in running stateless applications. Or we have a few examples of sort of what I like to call dumb clusters. Like we're running, for updates, we're running Core Roller, which is just a sort of handling Core OS updates. And it's just a interface where you need to configure updates, and the state's important, but it doesn't need to be, like we can lose a minute of data. So it's just backing up to S3 every minute, and if it respawns somewhere else, it's actually gonna restore itself from backup. So it's stateful in the way that it will retain state, but maybe lose a minute's worth.
Yep. You were mentioning that you're responsible for provisioning CoreOS units. How do you do that? Because I thought Ansible needed Python.
It does. Good question. So what it does is, so when we first provision an Ansible node, is that it's bootstrapping a portable Python on it. So what it's actually doing is Ansible has a mode called raw, where it's just sending SSH commands just as commands. So I was actually checking like, hey, is Python installed and available? No? Okay. Downloads portable version of Python and uses that for Ansible. And everything works, which is very surprising. Like even systemd control and all that stuff. I haven't run into any actual Ansible bugs with it.
Could you name a few things that you do while configuring a node? Like copying SSL certs on it or...
So the only real thing that happens besides sort of any sort of central management that's specific to our environment is actually installing the node exporter for the monitoring and also configuring some Docker things like setting the log limits that are available, setting that network that we set for the routing, and actually installing the binaries for the kubelet and the kubeproxy. So besides that, there's really not a whole lot of special things going on. So the actual nodes themselves probably could just be configured with CloudInit and Terraform like we used to do, because they don't really need to be aware of the master components, but it is really nice to be able to use Ansible to actually configure it and then wait for it to come back. So it means even if you really screw up, that you know that you can only kill one node, which we consider acceptable.
So you're not using the kubelet wrapper provided by CoreOS to run the kubelets?
So we, when we first started out, we like trusted CoreOS and we're using the automatic updates. And then they randomly removed the SOCAT stuff. And they moved Flannel from a Docker container to a Rocket container, which actually changed the default environment file for how it was configured. So what happened is our CoreOS nodes did a rolling upgrade, moved Flannel from Docker to Rocket, lost its configuration, and basically caused split brain for everything and for everything to not work. And at that stage, we're like, okay, these stable updates are not really, like they may be stable, but they're not backwards compatible. So we actually have to run our own sort of CoreOS update mirror so that we can actually pin versions where we say acceptance is now being upgraded to this version or the testing pipeline is upgraded first and then rolling that out to production, because otherwise if you go, okay, let's update acceptance today and update production tomorrow, maybe a CoreOS update will come out in between and you can't actually guarantee what version will be running.
So you're actually using only the pre-installed Docker as a CoreOS feature, nothing else that Corvus provides.
Pretty much. So it's just a up-to-date environment that's managed with Docker with very little anything else running. So because we dropped the flan all in. Well, etcd is built in as well. But that's also an issue. If you were to have Corvus automatically updating, etcd 3 comes out and they go, yeah, it's stable, but you know, it might break etcd 2 instances. You wouldn't just want a rolling upgrade. So some people might say that Corvus automatically rolls back if there's a failure, but Corvus considers an update failure to be if it can't boot the kernel. So if it boots and Docker doesn't start and flannel can't start and anything like that, Corvus goes like, yeah, everything looks pretty all right. And that's not really, really good enough. And then when they rolling restart, you have nothing left at the end of it. I've got 4 minutes left. Yeah, great.
How do you do user management? How do you, so the people using the subcluster?
Yeah.
Their own access? What do you do?
So right now, because security is not yet a concern, a priority, they manage their own tokens. So there's not actually, what we want to do is we're using Okta, we're moving to it, because we want to put that in front of it. And that's a sort of access management tool where that will actually be doing the authentication for it.
Sorry, what was it called?
Okta. So this is something you can put in front of Slack and in front of Office 365 and those sort of tooling, where you can actually have it centrally managed. Any other questions? Yeah.
What do you use for storage?
Just normal disks. And disk IO is not really important for...
Normal disks?
Yeah. There's nothing special going on there performance-wise or anything.
Okay.
Because I think one of the things I need to say is that with Schuberg that most of the kind of workloads we have are really about 100% uptime and stability rather than huge scaling web services and things. So for them, it's really just an easy way to deploy and manage an application or a lot of applications rather than can we scale one application to ridiculous sort of levels.
Netapps. Those get all mounted as a disk in the VM.
It's good having a class tech guy here. This is great.
Class tech guy. It's called Cosmic, by the way. Because we fork cluster, we don't have to.
Did you rename all the APIs internally and stuff?
Doesn't matter.
Anyone else?
Yes. How would you protect namespaces so people can only access one?
So we were using RBAC originally, which allows you to do that with tokens. And then we found out that was an alpha API feature. And when we tried to upgrade to 1.4, our current policies weren't working and stuff. So right now, that's also up to the people using the cluster to manage. So the idea is that a sort of team or an application gets its own cluster, and we hand that over, here's your API. You guys manage this in the way you see best. So the thing is that like, you can protect a namespace, but there's nothing stopping someone from connecting to resources available in other namespaces via the API. Yeah, that's on a network level.
Yeah.
But it does go against the whole all containers connecting to all containers thing.
No, but you can define, but then in Calico you can define network policies.
Yeah.
So, I mean, by default, everything can talk to everything unless stated otherwise.
And how would this be configured via Kubernetes?
You will need to create objects of type network config. There's an object type called access config or network config.
Yeah, so it's actually in the API now to configure ACLs, but that's cool.
Yes.
I'm learning more than you guys. Egress. This is great. Sorry?
Egress is.
Okay.
For containers.
Yeah. Okay, cool. I'm out of time. Thank you.